Hello everyone, and welcome to this Moodle Academy webinar, What's New in Moodle 4.4? I'm Mary Cooch, Education Manager here at Moodle HQ.
And I'm Helen Foster, Community Engagement Advisor at Moodle HQ.
So we're going to be talking to you today about Moodle 4.4. And we've quite a lot to go through, so here's a list of everything. We'll do them in a few sections at a time, and we'll pause between sections to see if you have any questions. Then we should have some time for general questions about Moodle 4.4 at the end of our presentation as well. And there is a lot to talk about, so let's get started. I'm going to begin by going through the significant course page improvements and the new activity icons, and then an easier way of locating how to reuse course content. So in terms of course page improvements, I'm going to go through these bullet points, but then we thought the best way to explain it would be to compare and contrast with a Moodle 4.3 course and a new Moodle 4.4 course. So we'll show you visually what these actually mean. So in Moodle 4.4, sections are now encased in cards for better focus. And if you've ever used the setting, show one section per page, that's much easier to navigate, easier to look at. And in fact, there is a whole new page just dedicated to each section. As a teacher, you have a clearer edit mode and you have a new link to view a course section when you're in edit mode. Our activity icons, which were previously quite large, they are small, they are different, they've been checked for accessibility with special colours, which also are linked to categories. Equally, if you upload files now into Moodle, you can see from the graphic or the text in the icon what kind of file type it is. And a heads up that the topics course format, which is still there, it's just been renamed to custom sections. So let's begin with a few screenshots to clarify what I mean with this. So here we have a course, cross-cultural communication in Moodle 4.3. And what you will notice is that each of the activities is encased in a card. So we have an activity card for the course notice board, for the choice, and so on. And then the sections are divided by a line. Now, in Moodle 4.4, this is actually the other way around. So if we look at exactly the same course in Moodle 4.4, you'll see that it's the activities which are separated by lines, and the course sections have a card around them. If I scroll down the page, so if we go further down, again, you can see the section Understanding Cultural Dimensions and Navigating Communication Styles. They are in cards for easier focus. And this focus is a very important thing. In the course settings, as a teacher, you can either have your topic sections viewing them all on one page, as here, or you can set it to show only one section per page. If you're using Moodle 4.3 and you've got that, then as a student, the first time you come into a course with show one section per page, you'll see the top section, the general section, and any information in there. And then you'll see the other sections kind of collapsed, just their headings, and you can see grayed out which activities there are. So there are two activities, a quiz and a glossary, and any progress that you've made. If our student clicks on the section called Why No Meat, we need to be in English, sorry, for the caption language, I'm afraid. If someone could change that, this is just for our recording purposes. Why No Meat, then, if she clicks on it to see just that section, then she sees just that section. She sees the quiz and the glossary. However, she has this welcome section at the top, the general section, which is kind of redundant because she didn't want to see that. She only wanted the section that she chose. So in Moodle 4.4, this is slightly different and it's better. So in Moodle 4.4, this is the show one section per page setting. The first time a student goes there, she sees the top section, and she sees the collapsed sections. It doesn't actually specify the types of activities, but it still tells her that she has two activities there. So if she clicks to access one section, that is exactly what she sees, just the items in that section. And her page is not cluttered up by the distractions of the top section, the general section. Now, this isn't only for the setting to show one section per page. So if we go back to our sample Moodle 4.4 course, Cross-Cultural Communication, which is set to show all sections on one page, if our student clicks on a section, for instance, Understanding Cultural Dimensions, then again, she just sees the items in that section and she sees them on a completely separate page. She can, when she navigates back, she will navigate back to, if she's in the section, she'll navigate back to the main course page. If she clicks on one of the activities, she will then in the breadcrumb trail, the navigation trail, we need to have the captions to English, sorry. She will, if she navigates from an activity, she will go back to the section and then she can navigate back to the main course. Or, of course, for easy going anywhere, you can use the course index. Now, another thing to notice here is the attractive little activity icons. So you can see they've changed. You can see also that they have specific colors. So if as a teacher, you went to the activity chooser to select an activity or resource, these are what the new icons will look like. These are the new standard icons in Moodle 4.4. And there was a lot of research done on this, and particularly with relation to the colors. We asked people with various sight challenges, and they've also been categorized. And I'll show you the color codes and the categorizations here. And yes, if you are an experienced Moodler, you might think that it's quite difficult to categorize certain activities because you can use them in different ways. But as a very broad picture, we have an assessment category, which is a kind of pink. We have a shade of blue for collaboration, orange for communication, brown for various interactive content, and a teal for resources. You have the actual codes there too. But it's not only the activity icons which have been changed and improved. There was some disappointment in earlier versions because when people uploaded files of different types, it was hard to see what it was. So now, and here in fact, is another of those new section pages, which is just a section with useful resources. Here we can clearly see that the first handout is a PDF because we see it from the icon, the MIME type. The next one is a doc, a Word doc. There's a PowerPoint presentation. And then this icon here is there's a graphic in there. So this will be an image file of some type. And the T in the video transcript tells us it's a text file. Okay, so we've looked at the general course page and activities mainly from a student point of view. If we now look at what's changed from the teacher's point of view, if we go into edit mode, the first thing to see as a teacher is the nice dotted lines dividing everything up. And of course, you simply need, as previously, to click into a dotted line, for instance, here, to click the plus, and you can add an activity or resource wherever you want. What is new also is if you click the three dots against a section, you've got a new view link. And this, as a teacher, will take you straight to that new section page where you can view it and edit it if you want. Of course, as with a student, you can always access everything from the course index. When you have edit mode on as a teacher, you can't click the section title because that is where you would actually edit it. Also, as a teacher, if you go to your course navigation and you click settings, you can change or select a course format. So if you had a brand new empty course and you wanted to choose the course format, you'd actually see that the way it's displayed is much clearer because the description for each of these course formats is directly on the course page. And this applies also if you're using contributed course formats. And something to mention then, topic sections, that you still have topic sections, it's just they've been renamed now to custom sections. And this is kind of preparing or paving the way to some work we will be doing in later versions of Moodle to having subsections. Another new thing you'll notice, if you choose custom sections and you have a blank course ready for you to start modifying, is that when you go to your page, you won't see topic one, topic two, because the numbering has gone. You'll only see new section, and so on, which of course you can edit as you wish. Also, for teachers, I think a lot of people will be grateful for this. If you wanted to back up your course or restore a course or import some information, it's not easy to remember, but you needed to go to more and then course reuse, and then you had to remember where to find the various options. Now, you simply go to the More tab, and when you click course reuse, anything that you can do as a teacher is directly on the page for you to access. Import, backup, restore, reset. I've highlighted copy course because editing teachers don't have that by default, but either if you're a manager or you've been given that capability, you'll see that there as well. Okay. Now, those are some improvements to the course page, course reuse, activity icons. Before I move on to talk about the ordering question type, Helen, is there any comments or questions you'd like to share?
Yeah, there's been a few comments and questions. First off, Trent says that the course page improvements, his favourite item so far is those new icons. And his least favourite item so far is that the general topic doesn't display in the other sections when you're using show one section per page. It's indeed a difference in 4.4. And Thorsten asks, are there settings to implement navigation between sections, i.e. arrows at the bottom for previous and next section? Or is the course index on the side, which is likely to be hidden or collapsed on mobile, the only quick way to go from one section to another?
I know what you're talking about. I know quite a few people liked the next and previous, but others found it confusing. My understanding is yes. I think you can use the course index, really. And using the mobile app, using the Moodle app, I think navigation should be okay. I don't know if you meant using it, using the web version on a mobile phone. I'm not sure. But okay, Sam says this will really help to reduce cognitive load. Looks so much cleaner. Thanks, Sam. Anything else or shall we continue?
Sam has helpfully replied to Thorsten's comment about the navigation between sections with a tracker issue, MDL 75683. So maybe you want to check that out. I'm not sure what it is offhand. And Trent comments, I used to have to use a different theme, Boost Union, to categorize colors of the icons. Glad to see that it's now in the main Boost. Okay, that's it for comments so far. Remember, as we go through, feel free to add any questions or comments you have in that chat.
Okay, then. So now I want to talk to you about an excellent improvement, thanks to the Moodle Users Association, sponsored this, which is the ordering question type. Now, the ordering question type is a very popular, long established question type, which was originally developed by community Moodler Gordon Bateson in Japan and has also been contributed to by other community members over the years. And thanks to a project by the Moodle Users Association, it's now gone into standard Moodle, which means that everyone will benefit, even if you're not able to add plugins. Because it is such a well-known question type, I'm not going to explain how it's set up and how it's used, but I just thought I'd show you some examples of ways in which teachers like to use this question type for sequencing things. So at its simplest, you could use this question type to put single words in order. So here we have a question where the student has to order low context, high context cultures or countries starting with low context, finishing at the bottom with high context. So that's just one word. Equally, in terms of, for example, teaching languages, which is my passion, then I would like to see it used for reordering dialogues. So having conversations, you need to put the conversations into the right order. So here you've got whole sentences or phrases. But also, if you use, when you're setting up the questions, if you use the HTML format, then you can also add media. So in this question, we have images where you have to put in the order of the stages of life. As you set up your question, you can either display it vertically or with some restrictions based on the actual formatting of the page. You can also order them horizontally as well. So that is a very welcome improvement thanks to the Moodle Users Association. I'm going to take a break now and I'm going to pass over the presenting to Helen.
Thanks, Mary. Well, I've got some interesting reporting improvements to share with you, custom reports and also some of the standard reports in Moodle, browse, list of users, config changes and badges all get some improvements. And also to talk about a new user tour setting. So first off, custom reports. These improvements are thanks to bringing in report builder functionality from Workplace. We have a new roles report source, a new file type condition enabling you to filter by file type, also an improved file size filter. We have the option to tag reports to easily find them later. And finally, a new capability, view all custom reports, which allows users to view all the reports regardless of audience. So let's take a look first at the new roles report source. This is useful, for example, if you want to report listing all users with the role of teacher in different course categories, as shown in this slide. It's also useful if you've got a workplace site and you want a report of all tenant administrators. Another custom reports improvement is that a new file type condition allowing you to filter by file type. Also, you can now specify units, for example, shown here, megabytes for the file size filter. A further improvement shown in this slide is a column in the report for file icons. So these improvements enable you to create a report of backup files in each course if you need to track down any courses with particularly large backup files, as requested recently in a Moodle.org forum discussion. So more reporting improvements in standard reports or also because of report builder functionality brought in from Workplace. We have the browse list of users in the site admin where bulk actions have been added. Also in the site admin, the config changes has a new filter by plugin option. We have more site badges filtering options and a new course badges filter. And finally, another new report of theme usage. So looking first at browse list of users, this page you'll see includes a space saving filter options and also bulk user options. So you can filter users, that's number one in the slide, then select them, number two, and then perform a bulk action such as adding them to a cohort, sending them a message, or even you might like to reset user authentication factors. Another standard report with an improvement is the config changes report that you can now filter by plugin. This was contributed by a community developer. And then we have the course badges filter. So the site badges filter options in 4.3, that's filtering by name, badge status, or date issued, they're now available at the course level in 4.4. Another new report in Moodle 4.4 is the theme usage report. This is good for sites with course, category, cohort, or user themes enabled. And this report shows where a particular theme is used. Now, while we're on the subject of themes, just like to mention that we've had some changes to the site admin theme settings. So in 4.3, they're in a theme section and they're moved in 4.4 and renamed advanced theme settings. And then the theme selector in 4.3 is now called themes. And if you want to get to the settings for Boost or Classic, they're accessed from this themes page via the Edit Theme Settings cog icon. Moving on to user tours, we now have a new setting to make a user tour show each time you visit the page. Currently, to see a user tour again, you have to reset it via a link in the page footer, but you can set the show tour to each time a filter matches it to make the tour always show.
Okay, thank you, Helen. I think we can carry on, actually. I don't think there are any specific new comments, no?
There's just one comment from Trent saying, my uni is about to lean into badges more heavily, so those reporting options will be helpful. Nice work.
Excellent, thanks. Excellent. Okay, so I'm going to talk about notifications, Tiny MCE, and if you're using Matrix, Matrix group support. So someone changed the caption language back to English, thank you. So for notifications, the most important thing to remember here is that in new sites, new 4.4 sites, web notifications are on by default. So in other words, if you've just set up a new Moodle 4.4 site, your teachers and students will be notified by default of anything which affects them, relevant to them, on the web. Equally, there are new notifications. An admin is now going to be notified when a task fails. Users who haven't been active in a course for quite a while will get notified before they get unenrolled. And one that we'll look at shortly is that now, if as a teacher, if you manually enroll a student, they will be alerted and they'll get a course welcome message. This is similar to what happens already if a student enrolls themselves into a course, they get a welcome to the course message. This is now also the case for when you enroll them. Now, there is an admin setting for that in Site Admin, Manual Enrollments, where the admin can decide who the course welcome message will come from. So by default, it is what we call the course contact. That's the first teacher in the course. But you can also set it to come from the key holder or from the no reply address. Now, if it's sent by the teacher, if a teacher manually enrolls a student, then this message will automatically get sent. As here, our student Barbara has been notified that she's now enrolled in the cross-cultural communication course. Even though she didn't enroll herself, she was manually enrolled. Now, re-Tiny MCE, as you've had plenty of warning, Tiny MCE, which is gradually going to take over from Atto, which will be removed. So Tiny MCE is now the default editor in all sites, and it's very, very well worth that for its many features, including its accessibility. And when you're using Tiny MCE, and when you are uploading an image, the way this is handled is much improved. So if we go to upload an image, we get a nice block here. We can drag and drop our image, browse for it, or add a URL. Then when we've selected our image, then we'll you can easily see and nicely see how to change its size, give it its alt tag, its alt text, and so on. Okay. Finally, in my little three sections here, in 4.3, the initial working with connecting Matrix to Moodle in terms of communication. So if on your site you have a matrix server, it's meant previously that teachers could have a matrix room attached to their course so that the teachers and the students could go and chat in matrix informally about the course. Now, new in Moodle 4.4 is that if as a teacher you use groups in your course, then there will be group rooms made within matrix for them to access. So in our course, we've got an alpha group and an omega group. And here we see our teacher and one of the students in the matrix chat or element chat just for that particular group. Now I'm going to pass over to Helen, unless we have any more comments or questions.
No, we don't have any comments or questions. Just a quick reminder, if you have any comments or questions as we're going through, feel free to type them in the chat. So on to activities. In Moodle 4.4, we have improvements to forum, quiz, and H5P, and some important changes you need to know about to Big Blue Button, chat, and survey. So forums, first of all, as per standard forum, you now have the option to set announcements forums defaults in the site administration. So for example, you might want to change the maximum number of attachments to 3, or 2, or change the subscription mode to auto. This improvement was contributed by a community developer. Also contributed by a community developer is a handy post a copy to all groups option shown in the quick discussion creation form. So there's no need to click that advanced link. This improvement was discussed on Moodle.org in a forum. Moving on to the quiz, also contributed by a community developer, similar to the workshop activity, which has 2 grade items for submission and assessment. Now in the quiz, you can create grade items also. So from the questions page in the quiz, you can choose to set up a grade for each section or manually create grade items. If you choose to set up a grade for each section, then everything is done automatically for you, as in this slide that's got 3 sections, and there we have 3 grade items set up with each section assigned to the grade item. If you have a quiz which doesn't have any sections, then you have the option to manually create grade items, as many as you want, and then select which grade item applies to which question. Then the quiz results page shows grades for each grade item in addition to the total grade for the quiz. Another quiz improvement, also contributed by a community developer, and inspired by a forum discussion on Moodle.org, is the last saved info in the quiz. This is very reassuring for students that the auto-save functionality is working correctly. On to H5P. In the site admin, we have a custom CSS setting, also contributed by a community developer, where the site admin can add custom CSS which applies to H5P content across the site. Moving on to activity changes that you need to know about. First off, Big Blue Button credentials. Since the 22nd of April, all sites using Big Blue Button free tier hosting need to now register with Big Blue Button to obtain credentials for your site. This applies not just to Moodle 4.4, but also existing sites which haven't yet upgraded. Then the chat and survey activities are disabled in new installs of 4.4. The chat activity is rather old-fashioned these days. We have Moodle messaging and communication options such as Matrix or a link to Google Meet or so. And then the survey activity is really hardly used at all because it's not customizable. So it's been decided that both should be disabled in 4.4 new installs, and they're due for removal in Moodle 4.5. So if you're upgrading your site to 4.4, you might want to check if these activities are being used at all, and if not, disable them in advance. Okay, moving on to the last two areas of Moodle 4.4 to talk about, authentication improvements. We have a new multi-factor authentication factor and a new login page setting. And then we finish off talking about the new capabilities in 4.4. So first of all, multi-factor authentication. To increase site security, you now have the option to authenticate by an SMS code sent to your mobile phone. Then we have a new login page setting in the site admin, password visibility toggle, which allows users to show their entered password as plain text. This option is disabled on upgraded sites, but is enabled on new installs. So good to know about it. If you're upgrading, you may want to enable it as well. And finally, looking at the new capabilities in 4.4, we have view all custom reports, allowing users to view all reports regardless of audience. This is something maybe for your manager role. It's not actually set for any of the standard roles, but you might want to enable it, or maybe a tenant administrator if you have a workplace site. Then there's the capability access tiny MC premium features, which allows admins to control which users can use these premium features and in which context to keep the cost down. This capability is allowed for the authenticator user role. And if you're interested in what the premium features actually are, it's go check out the documentation for TinyMC, because they're all listed there. And finally, a very popular capability has been added, the use upload course tools. This feature, the issue had 72 votes and dates back to 2013, so it was really great to see it finally implemented. And it enables non-admin users, such as managers, to use the upload courses feature. It's allowed for the default manager role. Okay, so that's it for all our slides. We're on to question time, and let's have a look in the chat.
Yeah, so Alex has said, it is very useful sometimes to see your password as a text when logging in from a mobile device. I've used that feature on other sites myself. It is helpful, I agree.
There's a question about Tiny MCE allowing direct imports from Microsoft Word without corrupting formats. I know that there's a clear formatting option in Tiny MCE. Do you know anything else, Mary, about that one?
I don't know anything more than what you said, Helen. No, I'm afraid. But if anyone in the chat does, feel free to say so.
Otherwise, please do ask about it on Moodle.org.
Yes.
Forum there.
Anna's saying, could you explain more about the use upload tool? I think what you mean is the final capability that Helen mentioned, which was this one. So administrators have always been able to upload a CSV file with information about courses to make Moodle automatically create the courses, so you don't have to do it manually. But managers have never been able to do that, even though managers have been able to upload a CSV file to create users. So with this new capability, managers or other people who you give it to can set up a CSV file with information to create courses and upload that. Is that Explained, Helen, yes?
Yep, I'm just finding the documentation link, which hopefully explains a little bit
Great.
more.
Lovely, thank you. Okay, do we have any more comments or questions about Moodle 4.4? We've quite a bit of time. Is there anything in particular that you are looking forward to trying or that you've been waiting a long time for, like me waiting 11 years for this latest capability? If you haven't seen them already, we have a playlist of videos on YouTube, which go through the main features. They explain, for example, the quiz improvements, forum improvements, course page improvements, activity icons, and the various reporting improvements that Helen went through.
We have a question. What is TinyMCE Premium? Let me just find the documentation link. So TinyMCE Premium requires a paid subscription and you get a number of additional features. Here's the link for you to read more about it.
And Sam says, looking forward to seeing how much tidier my courses are going to look, plus CSS in H5P. Okay.
Brent says, just overall, this is fabulous. Glad to hear you like it. I may still be limited to 4.3 until our student information system is certified for use with Moodle 4.4, but I am excited. That's great.
Okay, if someone can send the link to the Moodle 4.4 playlist from YouTube, then that would be very helpful as well.
Mark says there is a paste from Word Premium TinyMCE option. That's good to know.
If you access the Moodle 4.4 documentation and you look at the related pages, you'll see the videos in there as well. Thanks, Mark. Mark sent the link to that.
I just posted link to the playlist of 4.4 new features.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Martin. We will finish a little bit earlier if there aren't any more questions. We'll just wait a little while and we'll see. If you think of a question after the presentation, then please do go to moodle.org and feel free to ask your Moodle 4.4 questions there. Mark, yes, the presentation it's actually already on the 4.4 new, what's new in 4.4 course, and it is going to open up in about an hour, I think. And I do encourage you to go in and do the course where this webinar is living, where you came to access the webinar, because then you can either do it as an administrator and get an administrator badge, or you can do it as an educator, get an educator badge, or you could do both in actual fact. And we've got JR says, appreciate the failed task reporting to admins feature. If we aren't going to get any more questions, but we're getting some thanks. Oh, Dominic says, how long before the recording of this webinar is available? Our media editor, Richard, will be working on it tomorrow or Monday. So hopefully early next week it will be available. Okay, thank you. I just have a few things to say then. First of all, thank you very much for coming to this presentation. And we would love you to help us to grow Moodle Academy by contributing to its development. We run 2 webinars each month at least, but we would love you to suggest topics we can cover in future webinars and courses by joining our Get Involved course and making your suggestion. If you are a Moodle expert or experienced Moodler, you could volunteer to co-present webinars or co-create courses and share your expertise. And again, if English is not your native language, but you speak fluent English and you speak another language, please do help translate our courses into your language. And we have a special course, Translate Moodle Academy, where you can learn how to use our content translation plugin, and it is really good because it means people can access the course and immediately see our course materials in their own language. So spread the word, tell your friends and colleagues about Moodle Academy. Do our courses get a badge, as with the Admin and Educator 4.4 badge that you can start now? Please tell everyone about us. If you're an educator, an experienced educator, you might like to take our Are You Ready to Do the MEC quiz, which is linked to on the front page of Academy, to see if you're ready to take our official global Moodle Educator Certification Program via our Moodle Certified Partners and Service Providers, and have a HQ signed certificate saying that you are a certified Moodle educator. And thank you for your thanks, everybody. I think that is all from me. So very appreciative for all the people who join. Thank you from me, Mary Kutch.
And thanks a lot from me, Helen Foster.
Bye-bye.